بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. Dear brothers and sisters, حياكم الله to the translation of this khutbah which is titled by The Ways of Da'i. After the khutbah al-Hajar, then I said that Allah Ta'ala said as in Surah Tawbah ayah 122, وَمَا كَانَ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ لِيَنْفِرُوا كَافَّةً فَلَوْلَا نَفَرَ مِنْ كُلِّ فِرْقَةٍ مِنْهُمْ طَائِفَةً لِيَتَفَقَّهُوا فِي الدِّينِ وَلِيُنْذِرُوا قَوْمًا إِذَا رَجَعُوا إِلَيْهِمْ. Now should the believers all go forth together as a contempt from every exhibition remained behind, they could devote themselves to studies in religion and admonish the people when they return to them, that thus they may learn to guard themselves against evil. Yes, and there is not that some of them stand with the command of Allah to admonish the people, then they will not survive. And they cannot straight up themselves on the right path on the command of Allah except with the acknowledgement and the knowledge of what Allah Ta'ala has commanded with. And that is a matter which they cannot earn except by carrying the pure authentic knowledge from its people who are thiqat, trustworthies, and adul. And adul meaning capables of carrying the ilm. While turning away from this way is only considered to be a misguidance from the right path. And there will be no any Muslim, there will be no single Muslim who is worried about his religion and his ummah living today except that he feels the pains for what the ummah came to today. This ummah which Allah Ta'ala described as in Surah Al-Imran ayah 110 by saying كنتم خير أمة أخرجت للناس تأمرون بالمعروف وتنهون عن المنكر وتؤمنون بالله. You are the best of peoples involved for mankind in joining what is right, forbidding what is wrong and believing in Allah. Verily the Ummah today is taking itself to a very far depth of as what Allah Ta'ala described in Surah An-Nur ayah 40. بحر النجي, a vast deep ocean. يغشاه موج, overwhelmed with tub below من فوقه موج, tub by من فوقه سحاب, من فوقه موج, من فوقه سحاب, tub by dark clouds, ظلمات بعضها فوق بعض, depth of darknesses, depth of darknesses, one above another. إذا أخرج يده لم يكد يراها. If a man stretches out his hands, is hung, he can hardly see it. He can hardly see it. ومن لم يجعل الله له نور ومن لم يجعل الله له نورا فما له من نور. For any to whom Allah gives not light, there is no light. There is no light before. And the meaning of light is the knowledge and guidance. And guidance is only built on knowledge. You cannot be guided without knowledge. You cannot be guided without knowledge. But yes, you can be misguided with knowledge. With knowledge. When there is no sincerity behind seeking this knowledge. But if you are sincere in seeking this knowledge, definitely you are going to be guided. Definitely you are going to be guided. And the Ummah today, is like one who is thrown deep into far distant place. And that is only because they distant themselves from the guidance of the law, from the way of the prophet, from the way of the believers. And Allah Ta'ala warned us the consequences of such a very dangerous way. As Allah Ta'ala said, وَمَنْ يُشَاقِقِ الرَّسُولَ مِنْ بَعْدِ مَا تَبَيَّنَ لَهُ الْهُدَى وَيَتَّبِعْ غَيْرَ سَبِيلِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ نُوَلِّهِ مَا تَوَلَّى وَنُصْلِهِ جَهَنَّمَ وَسَاءَتْ مَصِيرًا. If anyone contends with the messenger even after guidance has been plainly conveyed to him and follows a path other than that becoming to men of faith, we shall lead him in the path he has chosen and land him in hell. That is in the hereafter. What an evil refuge. So what if the Ummah, contends with the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم in most of the ways of its life, in the Aqeedah? To limit today you see the fortune telling and witchcraft and magic spring amongst them, talismans, etc. Many other different ways of misguidance in the issue of Aqeedah. And in the Ibadah, up to the limits that the Sunnah is trying to be seen to the people as bid'ah, as Ibn Mas'ud said about this time. He said that the people of the Eid of Lahr going to see the bid'ah and find it as Sunnah, and the Sunnah bid'ah. So when anyone calls into a Sunnah with the proofs and evidences, they say, oh, the bid'ah is revived again. And when anybody calls into a bid'ah, they say, oh, the Sunnah is brought up again. Subhanallah. And the ilm is being abundant. The ilm, the true ilm, is being abundant. Very little number of people seeking ilm today. And when I say seeking ilm on the proper way, as yes, we do have a lot of publishing houses. As yes, we do have a lot of bookstores. As yes, we do have a lot of schools and institutes and universities. As yes, we do have lots of graduates, and many of them are carrying masters and PhDs. However, none of them except for little, unfortunately, having the real ilm. None of them, except just for little, and I say literally, and I mean what I say, unfortunately, little number of them, thinking that they are the scholars of today, believing that one who has PhD is a scholar. And the joke is, whatsoever field you have a PhD today, no matter what, you can talk about religion. No matter what. You have a PhD in medicine, you have a PhD in engineering, you have a PhD in mathematics, in whatsoever field. Even those who have PhDs in arts or sports, they have PhDs in sports today. And some PhDs are given as an honor from universities. Such type of person, yet use his DR, D, capital D, small r dot, to introduce himself as a scholar. Subhanallah. And people are accepting that. And they look at you and they say, which university are you graduated from? You say, I've been under Sheikh so and so, the Muhammad, the Faqih, the Alim, for 20 years, for 30 years. They say, no, no. Remember now. What certificate you have? What certificate you have? That's the only thing. You know? So we are in a big mess today. We are in a big, real serious mess today. Very serious mess. And some may not have certificates, but they may memorize, they read books and memorize some information. But they have very fluent and strong tongue. So they are considered to be ulama in the East and in the West, in both. And in the West is even worse. It's even worse. The advanced technology in the West consequence very low of Islamic ilm. Very low limit. I said it last Friday. Wallahi, and I swear by Allah, if I got to know Africa before Europe and America, I would never have been to Europe and America. I would never go to the West. Because there in the West they think that they are above everybody, even the Muslims there. Unfortunately, not all of them, but I can say 99% of mine. And Allah knows if I can get also of the 0.1 remaining. Very rarely you see people who are really serious and sincere and seeking knowledge. Even the graduates, let them know to take it from my mouth. Let them know to criticize me for this and I can bring you the challenges there. Let's go for a test. Let's go for a test on the basics. Basics of the Arabic language, basics of Rasulullah's book, basics of Mustalah, basics of Aqeedah, basics of everything. Even the graduates, they are very poor. Rather than those who just wear vitra and read vitra and wear vitra and come and speak in a very fluid tongue of American accent or British accent or French language or whatsoever language and think that they are the ulama. And they start bringing you information that because not only you as a Muslim, even the Muslims in Saudi Arabia may not use that because the pure ulama, the real ulama, do not bring this information. I never ever heard what the people say in the West by said by Sheikh bin Baz. I never ever, wallahi, I never ever heard it said by him. And if it would have been said by Sheikh bin Baz or Sheikh al-Zamin, maybe in the college for teaching the people, not to the public, to show that, oh, I have information. I have information, I have knowledge. No, it's not the way of God. Not the way. So the Ummah now, is rising, is thrown by the devil, thrown deep into far distant place. Allah knows best where it is going to stop. Allah knows best. And that is all because, as we said, that they have distanced themselves from the sources of ilm. Sources of ilm. When Shaykh Ibn Ibrahim, if you want to know Shaykh Ibn Ibrahim, Ikhwan, most of you didn't even see Shaykh Ibn Ibrahim. If you just want to know Shaykh Ibn Ibrahim, you can look to Shaykh Ibn Baz. Listen to Shaykh Ibn Baz. He was his student for 10 years in law, never left him. Until Shaykh Ibn Ibrahim commanded Shaykh Ibn Baz to go to Al-Kharj, River Riyadh, and go to Al-Kharj and be the judge there. If you never saw Shaykh Abdul Rahman al-Sahdi and you want to see how he was, just see Shaykh Ibn Ghazali. They say he is exact copy. It doesn't mean that he is just imitating, no. But he is influenced by the ilm, and this is the effect of the ilm. This is the effect of the ilm. If you want to know how the ulama speak and how the ulama can teach, then you just see to this, look to these people. Not to these, I'm sorry to call them clowns, riding members or climbing members, thinking that they are ulama. Thinking that they are ulama. And they are, wallahi, driving the ummah to a real, real dark depth. Now, and look at it, they abandon the ilm, and they mock the ulama. They mock the ulama. They mock them. They mock them, seriously, literally, they mock the ulama. They don't care about the ulama. And when they speak about the ulama, they speak about one particular alim, that's it. And the rest, you just forget about. You say, but Sheikh so-and-so said. They say, but Sheikh so-and-so doesn't know the street. Subhanallah. Who you are to judge him? Okay, bring me another Sheikh so that he doesn't know the street. You, the very minor aunt, say that this alim doesn't have the experience of the street? Who you are? Who you are? And this alim was the Sheikh of the Sheikh that he says that he knows this street more than him. Subhanallah. And his Sheikh is a very respectful scholar. And he never ever said that this alim doesn't have the experience in the street. But these ignorants try to put down the ulama. The way they like. The way just they like. If this alim goes what they like, believe me, they will raise him. And I saw them, my eyes. Nobody told me that. They were raising one student of knowledge. Not one, many. Students of knowledge who used to go there. Yani senior students of knowledge. And one of them was even not yani senior or even junior. But they were raising him, telling him in their hands like this. Sheikh goes, the Sheikh comes. Once this person, now when this individual, and when I did not criticize him by his name, but the character. I was there in the West and I spoke about his poverty in language and what I hear and saw. They cursed me out. They cursed me out, they removed even my lectures and everything. I said, no matter, I don't care about that. But later on, when this individual had a problem with their Sheikh that agrees with them, they put him down. They said he's Jahil. So all those who were taken from Jahil. And that is not a shame because they are pure Jahal. They are real pure Jahal. So the ilm is being abandoned. And the people of ilm being mocked. And their advices being treated like something silly. And look to the extent of the ummah when they've gone far away from and in their transactions. they cheat, they deal with riba, they deceive, they oppress, even between husbands and wives and fathers and sons and like that. And in their manners and characters, subhanAllah, they went far away from the way of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, very far away from the fitrah, the nature that Allah created people on. To limit that line become cleverness. And men started imitating women in their clothes, in their haircuts, in their speech, and women imitating men, and both imitating the kuffar. And يعني الله مستعان, الله knows best when this ummah is going to wake up. I said what I said, I ask Allah Ta'ala to forgive us all. And as I said at the end of this part of the khutbah, I said, by saying this, I don't mean that this is a ruling for the whole ummah. No, there are still exemptions. There are still people who try to keep themselves on the right path. Try to know the ilm, try to seek the ilm, the proper ilm, as Allah Ta'ala said in Surah 2, Ayah 117, فَلَوْلَا كَانَ مِنْ قُرُونِ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ أُولُو بَقِيَّةٍ يَنْهَوْنَ عَنِ الْفَسَادِ فِي الْأَرْضِ إِلَّا قَلِيلًا مِمَّنْ أَنْجَيْنَا مِنْهُمْ وَاتَّبَعَ الَّذِينَ ظَلَمُوا مَا أُتْرِفُوا فِيهِ وَكَانُوا مُجْرِمِينَ وَمَا كَانَ رَبُّكَ لِيُهْلِكَ الْقُرَى بِظُلْمٍ وَأَهْلُهَا مُصْلِحُونَ. Why were there not among the generations before you persons possessed of balanced good sense, prohibiting men from mischief in the earth, except a few among them whom we saved from harm, but the wrongdoers produced the enjoyment of the good, of the good things of life which were given them, and persisted in sin. So I said at the end of this khutbah, I said what I said, I seek forgiveness from myself and yours, wallahu a'lam. And then I began the khutbah by praising Allah Ta'ala, sending peace and blessings of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and his khulafa ar-rasleen, his companions, his family, his wives, and all those Muslims who followed him until the day of his action. And then he said, afterwards, all people, all slaves of Allah, verily, with the awareness of the majority of everybody, majority of the ummah, everybody, of the importance of da'wah and du'at, the da'wah itself and the da'is, in rescuing the ummah, in protecting the ummah. Except that, although they know that, but they still ignore them and abandon them, and abandon their gatherings and sittings. And this become a symptom of the destruction of the people of this time. And some of them, when they are asked why they are doing that, they say because we found some du'at corrupted. We say yes, that's correct. It's not yani something not true. It is true that some du'at are corrupted. And it is really scary matter. When you see the du'at corrupted, this is very scary matter. Or when you see the corrupted people become du'at, either the du'at corrupted or the corrupted people become du'at. And unfortunately I saw even du'at who were mashallah very good. Yani they either stop da'wah or minimize their activities in da'wah and feed themselves to provocations and calls and this and that, defense themselves and subhanAllah. And the ummah is running into the sink of the world. سبحان الله. Who will protect the Ummah? Who will protect the normal people? If the ulama either corrupted or following the ways of the corrupted people. سبحان الله. نعم. I said, but did the people know who the du'at in reality? Did the people know who the du'at in reality? That's a problem. Anybody sits on a chair in a mosque, or sits behind a TV channel, or sits behind the microphone of a radio station, or sits behind the internet, Allah knows best where he was, maybe in an internet cafe, and start giving talks, they consider him sheikh, alim, scholar, student of knowledge, subhanallah. They don't know who are the du'at in here. Now, they don't know them. They don't know who is the da'i, as I said. And that is because they are themselves ignorant. They don't know the ilm. And they don't go to the ilm. They don't distinguish between the one who calls the ilm and the one who goes for, as we call it, hatib ulayn. He got now to collect wood for making fire. He doesn't know he's going to grab a piece of wood or a snake. Because he doesn't know, it's night, it's dark. When you go for making wood at night, you cannot guarantee that you are not stung by a poison, insect or snake or whatsoever. Because when you put your hand, you don't know you are holding a wood or a snake. That's why they call him Hatib ulayn. Same person in the end. He's just picking anything. He doesn't know what he's picking. Sometimes they say, no, we only pick from Albani, which is authentic. Jazakallahu khair, that's good direction. You went to the proper way to give the end. But is all what Albani authenticated good to be used as a material of da'wah in this time? لا نفي. علي رضي الله عنه أو هؤلاء إمام بخاري in his book الصحيح in the كتاب of علم the book of علم he said that the alim has the right to give علم to some people and hold it from some others. Why? Because as علي رضي الله عنه said, you will never speak to some people with a speech that their intelligence, that their aql cannot reach, they cannot understand it, except that you have put them in the fitna, at the middle of the fitna. You have put them in the middle of the fitna. You already gave them authentic ahadith, but they are immature. They are immature in knowledge. They cannot cope with it. It's going to cause them fitna. And that's why Ali رضي الله عنه said, حَدِّثُ النَّاسَ بِمَا يَعْقِلُونَ. Speak to the people with what they understand. Don't just bring anything. If you know how to grab a book from the bookstore, from the shelves, they know better than you. If you know how to go to the internet and click on kitab so-and-so, book so-and-so, and it comes on the front screen, they also know that better than you. So what makes you better than them in seeking knowledge? What makes you better than them in seeking knowledge? So you have to watch out. What level of language you have? What verses of Quran you memorize? How is your implementation to what you know? Are you implementing everything you know? Or are you just doing like the Yahud? Commanding the people with what you don't do of the obligatory commands of Allah. So, the alim or the da'i, the real da'i, is that one who stayed by the ulama for long many years, not 1, 2, 3, 4, not 2 years in the Arabic Institute of the Jama Islamia or Jama al-Imam, and then went back home, mashallah, now he speaks better than them, but when I hear, I keep laughing of the major mistakes, and they criticize me for not having good English, like if the English language was the language for one of the prophets or messengers. I'm not surprised to speak English. I'm only using it as a necessity to convey the message. Other than that, I feel shame to speak English. Take it from me. I feel shame to speak any other language other than Arabic. Because Arabic is the language of my book, of Quran. It's not racism, but this is the language of Quran. And I feel shame when I make mistakes in the Quran language, in the language of Quran. I don't care about your language, if I make male, female, I don't care about you. I don't care if I put the plural instead of singular. It's not a real matter. It's like a wheelchair screwdriver, that's it. I only use it to fix my car. I'm not so worried about it. They blame me for, oh, you have no perfect English language. Do you want me to tell you what Napoleon said about English language? You will never even speak it. But in Arabic language, one of them stands to leave the prayer, and he, after 10, 15 years, giving da'wah to the people, he still starts to say, Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. What is that, akhi? Don't you feel it shame? Subhanallah. Oh, my tongue. What is your tongue? The Indian scholars, their tongue is Arabic? No, their tongue is not Arabic. Their tongue is not Arabic. But they learned how to recite correctly. And some in Africa, I've been to Africa. I've been to a place where not even a single Arab passed by. They swear by Allah, even the Mufti of that land swear by Allah that he never saw Arabic except when he came to Hajj. Next was me. In that land, we never saw any Arab. When I was teaching them, I was teaching in the Fusha. Students there who never been to any Arab countries, never saw an Arab by their eyes, they speak Arabic fluently. They memorize the Quran. They read the books in Arabic. Subhanallah. And I'm wondering how they can translate books if they don't know Arabic. I'm afraid that they take them to some even prefer translators to do them. Allah musta'an. And they consider themselves, mashallah, tulab ilm. And one tell me that, oh, Sheikh so and so recommended so and so. I said, what's so? And what? So what? Is Sheikh so and so prophet for me to take his witnessing, which I think it's false? I think it's false. Because I'm not the man. If any scholar tell me that what's appearing now at 1:34 minutes in the afternoon, what's appearing in the sky is the moon, I'm not going to take it from you. Even if he's a scholar. I'm not a blind follower. I have eyes to see. And I know these people who have been recommended as du'at and mashallah he can give da'wah. Is the religion owned by this scholar? No, okay. He's like us human, follower of Rasulullah. When he mistake, we avoid him. The Sahaba said that to Abu Bakr, to Umar, and to everybody. And as Imam Malik said, everyone we can take of his speech and we can reject, except the one who is buried in this grave. Pointing the grave of Rasulullah. So that is the thing, ikhwan. It's not as like this mess happening today, Allah musta'an. The real da'i is the one who spent long time, long, many years, as I said, even past 10 years, I mean maybe 20 or more, with their scholars, with their shuyukh. This is the alim. And this is the da'i. And the da'i is not the one who brings strange information to the people. Oh, I mean, mashallah, memorize it. Like one stands on TVs, always, carrying no paper, no book, nothing. And it speaks very fast. And it speaks very fast, huh? Like that. And Allah Ta'ala said, I told the other, I am the 22. And he says the ayah and he says, page number, line number, this is not the end of it. He told you page number of what? Which book? Printed in Kingfam, yani, press, or where? There are many other, yani, publishing houses which manage the Quran and different number of pages. One big font, one small font. When you want to attract people by saying the number of page, the number of line, the number of word, it's not the ilm. I don't know who Sheikh Ibn Baz, I don't even believe that Sheikh Ibn Baz memorizes the page number. It's not the marathi. It's to have the understanding of it. It's to have the iman from it. Act it. As Abdullah ibn Umar said, that they never used to pass an ayah, until they know what ilm in it, what iman in it, and act upon it. And that's why Abdullah ibn Umar memorized the Quran in 10 years. It's not because he's not a good memorizer. He was one of the 7 Sahaba who memorized the most hadith of Rasulullah sallam, which is only said by Rasulullah sallam once, and he heard it like, and he memorized it like 3 years. But the Quran is a different thing. Quran is a different thing, and even the hadith. But I mean, why did the Sahaba said, we learn iman before Quran. We learn the iman before the Quran. And look to the word iman. من كان يؤمن بالله من كان يؤمن بالله من كان نعم many things that يعني takes the meaning of iman. It's not only information. Implementation is more important than information. نعم يا أخوان. And it is not the person, the da'i is not the person who chooses يعني as they call it in English, jones. Jones means يعني words that only specific and level of people know, even in English. If I keep using these words, many of you do not know it because you only got this language from your mothers. You never went to college as a specialist in English language. And I was telling one of you this today, who's here. I'm wondering why the English speakers like Americans, British, Canadians, Australians, they consider that any English speaker, once you learn little Arabic, you can do translations. But for an Arab who studied yani, Arabic, he's Arab and studied Arabic, he cannot do translation because he is poor in English. I ask him, I don't want to go to that extent to a challenge in English. Because where I got my English is through the college, from the books. They got their English from the street. Like my Arabic, I got my Arabic in the college. And many Arabs got their Arabic just from the street. So when I read the ayah, alhamdulillah, and I understand from it. But they don't. I mean, these Arabs. Why? Because they did not have, although they are Arabs. And I'm wondering how an English speaker who maybe a wizard or a semi-wizard, I have two yani, titles with him, wizard or semi-wizard. Because the Muslims who are born in UK and America, I call them semi-wizards. I'm not worse wizards, worse than wizards. Because before the practice, they were even shayateen. They were even shayateen, many of them. Many of them. They were even shayateen. Now, mashallah, he started practicing. He became Sheikh so-and-so. And lots of books and lots of this and lots of. SubhanAllah. SubhanAllah. And he says that, today there is a talk by so-and-so, translation of the book of Sheikh Ibn Baz. Then, good, mashallah. Let's listen to this translation. Sheikh Ibn Baz said one line, and he said 2 pages. MashaAllah, is this translation? Is this translation? SubhanAllah. translation and explanation. And even cheating in the singing, subhanAllah. SubhanAllah. So the da'i, the real da'i, is the one who does not choose these words that people do not know, so they go misakeen, they go to the dictionaries and try to find it out. Nothing. Simplify your speech. Make it very simple for the very simple man can understand. That's how the ulama. It's not by wearing like the ulama. It's okay, good to wear like the ulama. But wearing like the ulama does not make you alim. Does not make you alim. Like what they said about Hajj. Yani they say, what is the saying about Hajj? They say, إذا حدثت بمال أصله صحتم فما حدثت ولكن حجة العير. If you perform Hajj riding on camels that you bought from a haram money, then you did not perform Hajj, but the camels perform Hajj. Camels do not perform Hajj, but it means that you are even worse than the camel that you are riding on. Same thing, if you wear clothes, as the Prophet ﷺ said, المستكثر بمال المعطى كلابس ثوب يزور. The one who wants to appear like he has much, he has money. Doing something is not given, or by saying that I have given this. He is like somebody wearing false clothes, fake clothes. Like you see today, they have brand and marks of trainers or clothes. Some in China or like that, they just fabricated. I use the same brand. Now, people see it, oh, mashallah, he's rich, he's wearing this type of clothes. But he's only cheating and deceiving. Same thing. They wear, mashallah, vitra and thawb. Now, mashallah. Okay, and then, what do you want to say? You are like those who are like this? We did not see you there by them. We saw Pakistanis, Indians, Africans with their traditional clothes sitting by the ulama, and they became ulama. The cloth doesn't change you. The cloth doesn't change nothing. It's not to wear like this so you become alim. Laugh. It's not if you wear the Afghani's hand become Mujahid, if they call them Mujahid, because they call them Mujahideen, and it become a saint now. If you get this heart of the Afghani's, you know as a Mujahid. No, it's not that way. Things are not happening like that. Allah understand. So I said that, it is the person, and the person who does like this is what Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, al-mutafayhiq. The Sahaba asked Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what is mutafayhiq? He said that he is the person who, speaks of, he doesn't know. Or one who seeks knowledge only to turn the faces of people towards him. It's not to correct himself and guide the others, no. He just wants to be, he is seeking fame, that's it. He's seeking fame. Exactly. He's only seeking fame. Yeah. The da'i who wants to practice, what do you call that? Alhamdulillah, this is one of the proofs that I'm putting in English. So when I stand before Allah, I say, oh Allah, I was pure in English. And inshallah, I really hope that Allah reward me for that I am poor in English. Now, what do you call this? Qutta' al-tariq. The thieves who cuts the way of the caravans.
Highway robbers.
Now, he stands on the way of the people when they are going to the ulama as a highway robber. He stands the way going. Okay, you know why the vitra? You don't see it? You don't recognize the ulama? Why need to go there, And the da'i, the true da'i, is that one who has equipped himself with the proper knowledge, pure knowledge, which is established on the Quran and the Sunnah, but it never comes out of the way of the understanding, or comes out of the understanding of the pious predecessors, the Salaf, Sahaba, the Tabi'een, the Ulama, like that. Now, the Da'i, the real Da'i, the true Da'i, really feels sorry for what you see today, that the best weapon of the Ummah against its enemy, the Shaitan. The Shaitan is the real enemy, Akhwan. It's not the only the Yahur and the this and that and the... No. The real Shaitan for the whole Ummah, the whole mankind is the Shaitan. What is the weapon that we carry against him? It's the Ilm. It's the Ilm. Now today you see the Ilm collapsing. This woman is collapsing, deteriorating. Now, by the hits of the Shaitan. Like we are carrying wooden swords and the Shaitan carrying metal swords. With one hit, half of our swords gone. So that's what's happening, because we're not carrying the real weapon, the ilm, pure ilm, which is based upon the Quran and Sunnah understanding of the Sahaba. The Shaitan, which never felt tired by turning the faces of the youth of the Ummah from the way of its Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam up until they missed their way at the middle of the desert. They cannot know where is the way, the proper way, and they cannot guide others. They themselves are lost. They are lost at the middle of the desert. Wherever you look, only desert. Or at the middle of the ocean. So they cannot know where is the direction. Know that they can guide others to the direction. They are lost. And there, at the middle of the desert, Shaitan came to them, and he stands as a barrier between them and the destination, leaving them in the middle of the desert, which is very dry, very, very dry, extremely dry, no drop of water, so soon they will die because of thirst. Or in a place, in a land which is muddy, so their caravan will be stuck in the mud, so they can't move. And then the thirst, other things, other factors, kill them, like a death trunch of a palm tree, as Allah described. كأنهم أعجاز نخل خاوية. The real and proper da'i, ikhwan, really feels sorry and painful for seeing the Shaitan and his supporters succeeding in that and implementing their plans. And he feels sorry when he sees the net of the Shaitan, which is buried everywhere, full of not fish, not deer, but human beings. Human beings being trapped by the Shaitan. And this da'i feels sorry for that. And this da'i is looking to the Ummah, the whole Ummah now, today, following the way which is a different way from the way of Rasulullah ﷺ, and finding the Ummah being cut in pieces, but without a knife. Without a knife, it's only by the desire and ignorance. May Allah Ta'ala will take the Ummah and bring it back to the first generation situation, and may Allah Ta'ala bring life to our hearts by remembrance of His subhanahu wa ta'ala, and raise our honor by being dutiful and grateful to Him, and protect us in our religion, our land, our rulers, our scholars, ourselves, our families, and protect our security, and make us from those guides to the Haqq, who are upon the Haqq, والله أعلم، وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وصحبه. These are worries of a da'i that I wanted to expose out of my chest, as I found my chest becoming too small and too narrow, holding them in it. Maybe one of those who hear me can do something to correct the situation. Allahu musta'an. صلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه.